Good morning. We want to welcome everybody out this beautiful Lord's Day, and I hope y'all are having a good Lord's Day so far. For our announcements this morning, we've got a few things that we can go over. We've got our ladies' event at 6:30, the ladies' Bible study. Be me here. I don't know if y'all noticed a lot of the pictures flashing yesterday. They had one of their events yesterday where they had a craft time. It's pretty neat. They made some really pretty stuff. And yeah, you can see all the things. They were having a good time being crafty. So I don't sound quite as good as it should, does it? All right. We want to thank the ladies for getting that on for this group. Our youth event that we had going on the 17th, we're going to have to postpone it. There's a whole lot of the kids, their families are on vacation or different events that are coming up, so we're going to take and postpone it out just a little bit more so we can get more of our youth included. Also, on August the 8th, we're going to have a church lunch after church. So let's plan on doing that August the 8th, and I want to encourage everybody to come and stay and enjoy that time of fellowship that we'll be having. Also, don't forget, we've got Sunday school going on, and they're doing a great study, the adults in James. Got the kids, we're having their classes, and the teens. Starts at 9:30, and I want to encourage everybody out to put that back in their rotation. It's something that I'm sure you would benefit and enjoy at this time. As far as prayer requests, we like to remember a few people. Bean, would you mind to share what's going on with your mom and how we can pray for her?
Mom's home now. Mom's been a few days in the hospital this week, but she's doing better. She's dealing with a liver condition that's caused some complications with both her esophagus and some of her digestive system. So she's went through some treatment. She's got some follow-up appointments this week and then another couple of months. But she's home. She's resting, and she wanted me to pass along her thanks for everyone's prayers.
Let's continue to remember Ben's mom. She's having some liver conditions that's causing other problems. And she is at home right now. She had to spend a couple days in the hospital. But we do want to continue to pray for her and the treatment that is to follow. So we thank you very much, Ben. Are there others that we can be praying for in our congregation? I know we hadn't asked about Joey Beth in a while. How's Joey Beth doing? Great.
She did really well. We were surprised at how alert she was and coming in after dinner and an outdoor drama at 11:30 at night when she was wide awake, chewing her chewing gum. She said that was good.
Good.
Thank you.
That's great. That's great too. She said she got to spend some vacation time with her family. So.
Y'all have prayed for Charles Shetland?
Yes. Okay, we'll write that down and get it out in a better way to where everybody can. I keep forgetting that I'm not only talking to y'all, we're talking to those that are listening, but let's continue to be in prayer for Charles Shelter. This is somebody that actually got COVID, one of the earliest cases I think that I had heard of. So it's been a year close?
In October, they went to Grand Canyon and met a family there.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
And he's still in rehab. And the insurance is going to run out soon, and they'll have to start paying out of pocket for his rehab.
Wow. Wow. So let's continue to remember Charles and his family and the rehab that he's having to go through. All right. Any other prayer requests that we can mention? Our neighbor, Braden Carter, he's a young man, probably 13 or so. He recently went to a Bible camp this week and came home yesterday, started running a fever and things like that, and his mom took him and had him tested, and he has the virus. So let's just remember him that he can recover well from that. But good family. Andy.
Our counselors have to self-isolate, so that just encourages me to ask you to please pray for these camps. It's a very wonderful ministry, but it also has these dangers. So.
Absolutely. And I believe I understand right when you were sharing, they basically have a full camp that they're...
In fact, it's the largest we've ever had.
Yeah. So praise the Lord for that, and we just ask the Lord for safety. And then we're grateful that these youth can get to participate in these. All right, any other prayer requests? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for this day. Lord, truly we are a blessed people called by your name. We ask, Lord, that as we come in your presence, Lord, that first of all, you will be honored and glorified, that you will be praised, Lord, that we will be humble before you. Lord, as your people, prepare us for this day. Prepare us, Lord, to hear your word, Lord, to sing praises to you, to offer up thanks. Lord, we also ask for those that aren't with us due to health concerns and vacations and other things. We just ask, Lord, that you would be with them, Lord, bless them. Lord, we thank you for good news that we've heard this week of several of our friends that are facing health issues. And we pray, Lord, that you will continue to guide and guard them. And Lord, not only would your presence be with them, but Lord, help us to reach out in your name. Lord, to be your hands and your feet, to minister to these that have a need. Lord, thank you again for the way that you bless us. Lord, as we come before you now, again, Lord, prepare our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Shall we stand as we have our call to worship? Our call to worship is taken from Psalms 96, 1 through 3. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name, tell of his salvation from day to day, declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous work among the peoples. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
Bring forth the glory of God. Father God, we come before you now as your people, and we hail the power of Jesus' name. Father, we praise you because it is through your Son, Jesus Christ, that you made the way for reconciliation with you in the face of our defiance, of our sin. You provided the way for redemption and reconciliation by offering your only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross and shed his blood for our sin. We praise you, Father. Jesus Christ, we praise your name. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you, in fact, are Lord. For those who confess and kneel now, we have faith in your name, and the Father's wrath toward our sin is extinguished through your work on the cross, and we praise you for it. God, the Holy Spirit, we praise you for causing our eyes to see and our hearts to be opened to the reality of what the Father and Son have done. You cause us to have faith. You hold us to completion to the day of Christ Jesus. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we come now and ask that you would meet us in this place, that you would work in us what is pleasing to you. In the name of Jesus, we ask. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. I remembered a little late. If you would, join me for our confession of sin to a God who is all too ready to forgive and restore. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed. And grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. Now please take a moment to silently confess your own sin before our God. Now hear the assurance of forgiveness. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool.
I want to invite the praise team to come forward and please stand with us. I just want to remind you, go ahead and stand. Go ahead, it's all right. You know, we're now in week, what, four or five since we had this lightning strike nearby and has done away with some of our sound equipment. We're still trying to get everything working, but I've been so thankful for Ben and Carl and all those who have been proactive in taking care of things. We're still running kind of short on electronics, which hopefully doesn't really influence you guys much. Hopefully everything will be just fine. But I've been so thankful for the ways that the Lord has used these men and in figuring these things out. Hopefully we'll get back up and running with our full soundboard at some point. But regardless, we are here to worship the Lord. And we don't even need electronics to do that. Believe it or not, for hundreds and hundreds, we could even say thousands of years, people have worshiped the Lord without electronics. So let's praise the Lord through song.
Everyone needs compassion, love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory.
Yesterday when the ladies were doing their craft thing, they also did a whole lot of crafts for the people that are shut in, which is really neat. They did a real nice picture board, note board, whatever you want to call it, and they were talking later about, you know, what do we put beside the note board, you know, as a saying or anything like that. And we were trying to go over a few things like that. And I think it ended up, what, count your many blessings, which, you know, If we wake up each morning and do that, it's perfect. It's perfect for each. I was thinking more of a lot of people wouldn't know how to take it. It's the next song we're going to sing. That each morning when we get up, we walk to it and we say, Lord, I need you. You know, that's a hard thing to admit. We think we've got it all together. Everything's perfect. Everything's the way, you know, I can make it go and all that kind of things. When truth of the matter is, you know, Lord, I need you. I need to know how to start this day. I need to know how to act during the day. I need to know how to finish the day. I need you. So good song to put in her head. And I've had the privilege this week to work at Miss Mary McFadden's house. And I don't know if y'all know this or not. She's a whistler. You know what? That is a lost art. That is a lost art for one of two reasons. One, I love to hear people whistle. And if you're whistling, there's a peace in you that's just, it's comforting to me. I love to be around people that are like that. So, and I think that joy that's in your heart is the only way that you can have it, by knowing that the Lord is with you.
Oh God, how
we have the privilege of coming before the Lord to bring our prayers to Him, to feed on His Word, to feed on the sacrament. I just love the fact that God has given us the direction in how to pray and how to worship Him in His Word. Jesus Himself giving us the pattern in which we ought to pray. And so I ask that you would pray that with me now, the words that our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Father, we continue in an attitude of prayer before you, coming to you as your children, knowing that you hear our prayers because of the shed blood of your Son. Because of his blood, we have been made heirs, joint heirs with him. We've been adopted as your children by faith in him. And because of what he's done, we know that you hear us. Father, there is so much that we can bring before you now as your people. Concerns that are on our hearts. Some of us are affected by economic changes in our lives, relational changes or hardships, physical hardships, maybe even fears of various things that are going around in our nation and in the world. But we come to you, Lord, as your people, recognizing that you are sovereign in all things. And while you do call us to act wisely before you, to not turn a blind eye to injustice, to love our neighbors, to care for those who are hurting. We also recognize that nothing takes you by surprise. And so often our discomfort, so often our pain, is that we want to control situations, relationships, people, for our own ends, instead of entrusting these dear ones to you and asking you, how would you have me serve them? Father, I pray that those times when serving others needs to take a courageous stand, that you would empower us by your Spirit. When serving others, as you direct us, means that we humbly say, I'm going to hold my tongue, that the Spirit would prompt us and help us to do that. You have called us to move into the lives of others, Father, through your word, to bring the hope of Jesus to bear in the very realities of the life that we all go through. Help us in that. Strengthen us. Help us to surround one another in encouragement, in love, in challenge, rooted in your word. You've given us what we need for life and godliness in the pages of Scripture, and you've promised to work by and with the word by your Spirit. I pray that we would humble ourselves before you by submitting ourselves to the word of God, which is our only rule of faith and practice. Submitting ourselves to the work of the Spirit and moving forward in this life as your children, guided and directed by you. We thank you for the privilege that you've given us to do such things, to be your ambassadors, even though none of us are equipped and none of us are skilled enough, none of us have what it takes. That's not what you require. You simply require us to humbly and boldly follow you and lead others to follow you. Help us in that, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd invite you to turn to Exodus chapter 34. This is not the Gospel of John, by the way, in case you were thrown off a little bit. Throughout the month of July, we're going to be touching on various themes. To have a little bit of a break from the Gospel of John, since we have so many on vacation schedule, so we can all be studying that together as we come back together. So we're looking at Exodus 34 today, and you may wonder, why are we looking at Exodus 34? That's a great question. Mike Leonard, could you answer that for us? I'm kidding. No.
Because
we're supposed to. There we go. There's one phrase in Exodus 34 that we're going to focus in on today. And let me set the context for you. We're going to look at the theme of God's patience. We're going to look at why is God patient. You may wonder why, or maybe you haven't thought about it much. You just know that He is. But before we jump into this, I just want you to understand that when the Bible talks about patience, its opposite is not just impatience, it's anger. In fact, we're going to see the phrase that's used of God is not God is patient, but God is slow to anger, because that's the opposite. And whether we want to admit it or not, and we'll tease it out a little bit later in the sermon, but all of us struggle at some point with anger. Whether it's seen with full-blown anger or just an impatience of others and what they do, it comes in many forms. But to get to where we are in this passage, I want to remind you what is going on in Exodus. God has delivered His people out of bondage to Egypt. He's brought them into the land of promise. He's given them His law. Moses has gone up to Mount Sinai, where God has etched with His own finger in tablets of stone the Ten Commandments. While Moses is up there, the people decide that it's a good idea to make this bronze calf, this golden calf, excuse me, and bow down and worship God through it somehow. And Moses comes down from the mountain, and he's more than impatient. He's angry, and he breaks the tablets with the Ten Commandments. And so now we come to Exodus 34. I'm going to invite you to stand if you're able. We stand in honor of God who has given us His holy, inspired, inerrant word. I'm going to begin reading at verse 1. Hear the word of the Lord. The Lord said to Moses, "Cut for yourself two tablets of stone like the first, and I will write on the tablets the words that were on the first tablets which you broke. Be ready by morning and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai and present yourself there to me on top of the mountain. No one shall come up with you, and let no one be seen throughout all the mountain. Let no flocks or herds graze opposite that mountain." So Moses cut two tablets of stone like the first, and he rose early in the morning and went up to Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hands two tablets of stone. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, "The Lord, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and the fourth generation." And Moses quickly bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped. Father, we pray that you would take this, your holy word, and make it sweeter than the drippings of the honeycomb. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be found pleasing and acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. So back many years ago, Casey and I lived in Knoxville, Tennessee. We actually lived in the town of Farragut. This was before kids. It was before seminary. We just had a little dog named Shelby, and we had this little house that had a concrete patio on the back, and the previous owners had built a privacy fence, and you couldn't see the backyard because of the privacy fence. There wasn't much of a backyard, but we couldn't see it, and so we decided that we would like to remove the privacy fence. So that was my project on a Saturday. I was tearing it down, and there were some things that were just frustrating, and I know none of you ever get frustrated when you're doing projects around the house, but sometimes every once in a while I do. And so I was getting frustrated because these boards were not breaking the way they needed to, and I needed to get them to a smaller size. And I was really angry, and I can't remember now if I stomped on it or if I hit it with a sledgehammer or what happened, but I hit a board in my anger, and the board came about this close to hitting me in the head, and then I noticed that there were 2 4-inch nails sticking out of the end of the board. It's those sobering moments that you say, thank you, Lord, and why did I felt like Jonah in that moment. Do you do well to be angry? Sometimes we do get hit by the boards. Sometimes things do happen because in our anger we do something foolish. And I wonder what makes you angry in life. What are areas in your life that reveal that you're not slow to anger, but you continually are prone to it? How do you show your anger? You know, it is true that if we kind of had a continuum of how we express our anger, we have on one side kind of the obvious, red-faced, loud, boisterous anger. And I wonder, when we're in that mode, how do we deal with it when people expose our anger, when things happen that we don't like? I mean, do we just kind of dig our heels in and say, well, that's just the way I am, that's my personality, and we go on? And it's kind of insinuating that if you don't like the way I'm this way, that it's really your problem. And then there's the other side, the not so obvious, the I'm biting my tongue, but inwardly I'm seething. I stay up all night ruminating what I could have said and what I could have done to just get you. How do we deal with it? Maybe we do equate our silence with patience. Well, look how godly I am. Because I didn't say anything, and yet all the while we have this inner turmoil, we have irritable bowel syndrome as a result, and other things that because we just have this stuff going on inside us, all of us fit somewhere on the continuum. In fact, some of you may be thinking, I fit everywhere on the continuum depending on the time of day and the circumstance. All of us deal with anger at some level. And because of our unique personality, some of us might have more of a short fuse, some more of a long fuse, but the reality is we all have fuses. Throughout the Bible, we read scriptures that tell us there's great wisdom in being slow to anger. This means that there's great wisdom in having patience. There are some scriptures in Proverbs 14:29, that says, whoever is slow to anger has great understanding, but he who has a hasty temper exalts folly. Proverbs 15:18, a hot-tempered man stirs up strife, but he who is slow to anger quiets contention. Or what about James 1:19-20? Know this, my beloved brothers, let everyone be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. I mean, we read these scriptures and we say yes and amen, and we might even feel convicted, or we think about other people who need to hear those verses. But the reason they are in the scriptures is because we have anger problems. So where's our hope? Do we just, you know, ratchet down the anger and try to be better? If that's the case, that just rests on us, on our ability. Our hope isn't in just being more patient. Our hope rests in God
And what we see in the passage that we've just read, there's one phrase in the middle of all of this. This is a passage that's talking about the very character of God. God is telling Moses and the people, this is who I am. And in the middle of this, he says, I'm slow to anger. He's revealing his nature to his children. They've already broken the law that he established, and yet he returns to speak to them. That's amazing in itself. He's displaying his patience and his mercy in this moment by etching more tablets of stone for Moses and the people in the middle of their defiance. He's renewing his covenant with them. And in the middle of this, we see the Lord is slow to anger. There's four questions, and I'll repeat them as we go along. You don't have to write them all down right now. But there's four questions that we're going to look at today about the Lord's slowness to anger. First, what does it mean that God is slow to anger? Second, why is God slow to anger? Third, why do we need to know this? And fourth, how does this change us? So, what does it mean that God is slow to anger? Why is God slow to anger? Why do we need to know this, and how does this change us? First, what does it mean that God is slow to anger? The phrase there in Exodus 34 for slow to anger is an idiom. It's a Hebrew idiom. Now, we have lots of idioms in English. I had a professor that taught Greek in seminary who was German. He was German teaching Greek. He had married a woman from Texas. He loved American idioms, and he couldn't get them right. And so, like, he would be talking about something like, oh, we're opening a bag of worms now. Think about that. But think, what does it mean to open a can of worms? That's a weird phrase. We know it means, oh, something's getting really tricky here. That is a weird expression. And we can go through, what does it mean to fly by the seat of your pants? Really? We know it means to just wing it. Well, what does just wing it mean? You know? So this is a weird phrase. The phrase literally means, it's two words, it means long-nosed. The Lord is long-nosed. And we go, what? Let's start with the nose. The nose is referring to the nostrils that are flaring. It's a word that's used of horses when they're in anger and their nostrils are flaring. And so the word long, if you add it to that, is it means patience, it means slow to anger, but if we literally translated it, it would mean slow to snort in anger. But what a picture, right? It means long suffering, it means patient waiting. That's what it means when it says God is slow to anger. So what is exactly he waiting on? We'll see. Because remember the context here. God is talking to his people in the middle of their defiance and sin against him. They broke the first two commandments right off the bat when Moses was speaking to God. He said, you shall have no other gods before me, and you shall make no idols. Boom, boom. It's like, if you're going to do it, Martin Luther said, sin boldly. I don't think this is what he meant, but that's what they did. And so God is communicating his very character, that he is merciful and gracious, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. And in the middle of all of this, we see he is slow to anger. His patience is an aspect of his mercy, of his grace, of his love. One theologian wrote that God's patience reveals itself in the postponement of merited judgment. There's a context for God's patience. The context is the reality of our sin. That was the context in which he spoke these words to Israel. God is choosing to wait to pour out his holy wrath upon sin. So why? Why is he slow to anger? We can say, first of all, it is his character. This is an attribute of who God is. It's repeated throughout the Bible in Numbers, in Nehemiah, various Psalms, the prophet Joel, Jonah, Nahum. All of them repeat again and again, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Again and again and again, we hear this throughout the Old Testament. So it's rooted in his character. It's rooted in his faithfulness in the face of our faithlessness. But that does that really answer all of the question? Because we can say, well, God is patient. That's part of his character. But why is he patient in dealing with our sin? And we can answer that question by saying he made the perfect plan to deal with his anger. He made the perfect plan to deal with his wrath. His plan was rooted in his steadfast love and his faithfulness. His plan was to delay his wrath for a specific purpose and for a specific time. But make no mistake, God's wrath is toward sin. It is toward disobedience. And just because we do not see him act immediately now does not mean that he will not act. In order to deal with sin in a righteous and holy way, in a just way, God has to somehow exhibit his anger and extinguish his wrath towards sin. The Bible is very clear about that again and again and again. God will pour out his wrath on sin. That's what our sin deserves, no matter how great, no matter how small our sin is. In fact, a few weeks ago when we looked at John 3:36, we parked a little bit on this verse. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. And remember, when we looked at this, we talked about the fact that if you do not have faith in Jesus Christ, the wrath of God remains on you. In other words, everybody by birth is born into sin, and the wrath of God is directed toward us, every one of us that is naturally conceived. And I specify that because Jesus was supernaturally conceived. He was not born with a sinful nature. We were. And so the wrath of God is directed toward us and will remain on us if we do not believe in the Son. This is God's plan. This is God's plan to deal with sin, and we can say to deal with anger. I mean, have you ever wondered why God let, especially in the Old Testament, sin go? I have. I remember listening to a Rich Mullins song and something about Jacob, he loved Rachel, Rachel, he loved him, and Leah was just thrown in for dramatic effect. It's right here in the Bible, so it must not be a sin, but it sure does seem like an awful dirty trick. That was the lyric, okay? I love Rich Mullins' songs. I think he's wrong there. In fact, I believe he is wrong there. It's not that God was not going to deal with things. It's not that we don't see sin happen in the Old Testament. The question that we should ask is not is why is God so angry, but why did he delay his anger? There's got to be a purpose. We were talking about this in Sunday school this morning about something different, that it's kind of like those camera angles. Last year you would see, and I don't remember where it was, and I don't really care, but I remember seeing these different camera angles of crowds where you had one news source who would say, look at these crowds, they're all close together, they're not observing social distance because of one camera angle, and it's the same crowd, a different camera angle, and you see everyone spaced out like they should be. It's about perspective, right? What about the Old Testament? God is angry in the Old Testament, but he's gracious and loving in the New. Let's look at the camera angle. God is slow to anger again and again. Why? Because he had a plan to deal with this. And the anger of God and his plan is all centered on the cross of Christ. According to the scriptures, God's wrath will be taken out in one of two places. It is either taken out on those who remain under his wrath because they have not believed in Jesus. And so when Jesus returns on that great day, it's a day of joy for those in Christ, but it is a day of judgment for those who've rejected him. And the wrath of God will be poured out on our sin. And we will be separated from him for eternity, cast into the lake of fire. The only other option we have is belief in the Son. That when Jesus died on the cross, he took the full wrath, the holy wrath of God for our sin on himself. There's nothing we can do except embrace that gift that he's given us. He's the one who did it. Now, I know you hear me say this regularly, but let's look at Romans 9 for a moment. It's on your screen. Romans 9:22. Paul asked this question: what if God, desiring to show his wrath and to make known his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he prepared for beforehand, even us whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles? Paul is basically saying the same thing, that God in his patience has endured with patience the vessels of wrath, in other words, sin that's gone on in the world, so that those who are vessels for mercy, of mercy, those who would receive Jesus would, in fact, claim Jesus for their own, and the cross would be the place where God's justice and love meets for them. The wrath of God poured out for our sin on the Son as our substitute. Why is God slow to anger? He made the perfect plan to deal with our sin at the cross. One theologian wrote, the character of God's patience compels him to delay his wrath and thus allow and call for repentance. I mean, it is amazing, isn't it, that when Adam and Eve fell into sin, that God didn't simply wipe out the human race and maybe start over. Why did he not? Because his focus is on the cross. His focus in the Old Testament was on the work of Jesus on the cross. His covenants and promises constantly pointing to what Jesus would do. Guess where his focus is now? It's on the cross. So why do we need to know that God is slow to anger? So that we, if we believe in him, can rest in the sacrifice of his Son. Throughout the book of Hebrews, we read again and again that Jesus is the greater. He's the greater Moses. He's the greater high priest. He's the greater sacrifice. I've been reading through Hebrews very slowly over the last month or so, just in my personal times, and I've been struck again and again at times when I'm feeling actually kind of depressed and discouraged about different things going on in life, to be encouraged by the gospel. And in Hebrews 10, it's just amazing. Throughout the chapter, we read about how Jesus' sacrifice is better than the sacrifices of the Old Testament because the blood of bulls and goats offered each year cannot do what Jesus did. He completely forgives us of our sin in his once-for-all sacrifice. And in Hebrews 10, 8, so when it says in Hebrews 10, 18, that's on your screen, where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. In other words, Jesus has He is the offering. What he did on the cross is the sacrifice. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Do you want to know why we need to know that God is slow to anger? So that we can rest in the work of Jesus. These verses, if you're not familiar with them, read them again. Write down the reference. Go back. This is the hope of our confession, of what Jesus has done for us that we cannot do for ourselves. And as we rest in Him, we can then more easily identify the ways that we don't rest in Jesus so much. We're not a very resting culture, are we? I mean, we like to say we rest, but we also take some good things and turn them into our saviors. We work harder to do good things. Are we called to live righteously before God? Yes, absolutely. But so often we live our very self-controlled, disciplined lives by our own power, and we just kind of want people to notice, you know, well, look at me, look what I've done. And we kind of look down at others who aren't so disciplined at times, and even if it's in our hearts. Who's the real Savior then? Who's getting the glory? We are called to be broken over our sin, but sometimes we think that showing that we're true Christians means that we're working up a good emotional moment. Now, we're Presbyterians, and I probably don't even need to say that because it is kind of funny, but some of us who are more emotional think that the big thing is to work myself up, and to be truly broken over my sin means I'm only experiencing it emotionally, but are we really seeing how our sin affects others? Are we broken that we've defied God's word and God's law? We are called to press into our relationships with other brothers and sisters, and if we see things that look like sin in their lives, we are called to bring that to their attention as humble people that have our own logs in our eyes and we see the speck in our brother or sister's eyes. But so often we can go too far and we are only about exposing and condemning the sins and weaknesses in others. And we're not there to help. We're not really offering the balm of Gilead, the healing balm of Jesus Christ and His gospel. You see, we have this pride in our hearts that blinds us to things that are going on. It's a constant struggle. And that's why we need to constantly run back to Jesus and rest in Him, to remember what He's done for us. In fact, that brings us to how does knowing this about God change us? Instead of looking to ourselves as somehow being the ones that can kind of change the world and change people, we see what God has done for us in Christ, and we look at others through those eyes. Remember that parable that Jesus told in Matthew 18 about the unforgiving servant? The servant that went to his master, and if you tabulated how much he owed his master, it would be 200,000 years' wages. In a day before Mega Millions and Powerball, this would be impossible. And that was the point. And what did the master do? He forgave him. And what did that forgiven servant do? He went out into the world and he embraced the one who owed him just 100 days' wages, easily repayable, and said, "I forgive you." No, he did what we do. He grabbed the guy by the scruff of the neck and said, "You're going to debtor's prison until you can pay off that 100 days' debt." Why did Jesus tell the parable? Because that's the struggle of our hearts. How does knowing that God is slow to anger toward us change us? We see that He's slow to anger toward us. And when we see the offenses that others have against us, we're more able to forgive. We're more able to be long-nosed, to be slow to snort in anger. Patience is one of the fruits that we see, or one of the parts of the fruit that the Spirit works in us that reflects the very character of God. Anger, on the other hand, or impatience, is simply a product of self-love, of self-focus, of self-righteousness. The good news is that where God focuses all the time redirects our focus when we do get impatient, when we do get angry, when our pride gets in the way. We can go right back to the cross. We can confess our sin and know that through Jesus, God has forgiven us, and that by His Spirit, He is empowering us to go back to those that we have hurt in our anger and impatience, confess our sin to them, work toward reconciliation, and walk in newness of life when those things come up. I'd love to say that when I've had other work projects that I remembered that board with those nails. Maybe a little bit. We need reminders constantly, and God is good to give them. The good news is what He's done for us through Jesus Christ. Always, always before us. You may wonder when you're at Walnut Hill, why do you always go back to the gospel? Because it's everything. We never get beyond what God has done for us in Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that even now as we consider Your patience toward us, Your focus on the cross, that as we begin a time now of feasting on the sacrament, of feeding on the grace of Jesus Christ toward us, that You would minister to us, shape our hearts. In Jesus' name.
You can remain seated as we sing the first two verses of When I Survey.
I want to give a few practical instructions as we celebrate the Lord's table. Just in order, we've done this before, just out of precaution and for any of you that might be concerned, the elders are going to sanitize our hands. We'll wear masks as we serve, but you don't have to do that. You can come forward. And we will have two elders here at the front, and what we'll do is ask you to come through the center aisles to receive the element and then go back to your seat through the sides. Anyone that is remaining in their seats and needs to remain in their seats, I will come around also with a tray, so just stay seated and maybe just lift your hand up, and I will get there for you. So you got that. We're going through the center to come up and then through the sides to go back. So we're not going to have people directing traffic. But also, the elders will just place the cup in your hand, so just have your hand ready. We have a cup for the bread, and then we'll partake together, and then a cup for the juice, and we'll partake together. One thing that we talked about and sort of joke about as elders is when we're doing this, we don't get to partake while you guys are partaking. Otherwise, you know, we'd have to re-sanitize and all that. So we will partake after y'all. We always look at each other afterwards, and we're like, we didn't think about this. So, friends, we have a joy. As we've talked about the reality of God's focus on the cross, to celebrate the cross through a meal. He's given us something real, a tangible word, a sensible sign and seal, something that we can see, taste, smell, that represents the grace of God through Jesus Christ, his shed blood and his broken body. We're celebrating the gospel in this meal. This table is not a Presbyterian table. It is the Lord's table. It is for those who are baptized members of a church, who have professed their faith in Jesus Christ, to celebrate what he has done for us. The scriptures give us direction. As Paul writes to the Corinthian church, he writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" We celebrate this meal because Jesus instituted it for us to celebrate. There's nothing magical that happens to these elements. They're not transformed into anything. This is bread and grape juice. But the Holy Spirit will use it in the hearts of believers to nourish us in his grace. Let me pray for us. Father, we come to you now as your children. We've already humbly confessed our sins to you, and we confess anything that you might bring to our heart and our mind right now, knowing that in the blood and body of Jesus, we have been forgiven. You invite us to come to the table, to eat and drink deeply of Jesus. Father, even now we pray that you would take these common elements and minister your grace to us by your Spirit. May your grace to us today be as real as the taste of the bread and the scent of the cup. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, the elders, if you could come forward, they're going to station themselves here. And if you would just come forward through the center aisles, and they will place the cup in your hand with the bread, and then make your way back to your seats, and we will all partake together once you're back in your seats. Jesus offered his body to be broken on your behalf. Take, eat the body of Christ. The scriptures tell us that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness for sins. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. Let's respond in song by singing the last couple of verses of When I Survey. Please stand. It is good to be together today, and it is good to go out from here to celebrate who God is and to bring his testimony to the world. Now receive his blessing upon us, his benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
go into his world.